diverse districts in the country. And the data support from the most diverse in our congressional delegation. It's 50, it's changed tremendously in the last 20 years. 53% people of color, 40% foreign born residents, and almost 40% single female head of household. So the demographics have changed tremendously. So this is the most diverse and unequal district. Where in a 3-mile radius on a bus ride from Cambridge to Roxbury, life expectancy drops by 30 years, and median household income by $50,000. So entrenched inequities and disparities. And certainly there is an intersectionality in climate justice, in economic justice, in health justice, right? And so the flip side of that is where there is no justice, when there is not an intentionality in our policy making, then you have disparities. And neighborhoods that disproportionately have the highest asthma rates or cancer rates. Just as an example, the Green New Deal is sort of, it's a twin, it is aspiration. And the reason why it lifts up the New Deal is because there were many people left out of that. Indigenous people, Black folks, women. And so we need to support a new economy, and we need to save the planet. And so this allows us to achieve both of those ends. It's a very bold, aspirational values marker, which is serving as a legislative prompt to be more urgent in our efforts to mitigate climate, while also creating a new economy. And putting at the core of that, communities that have been disproportionately impacted by a lack of economic justice, by a lack of environmental justice, by a lack of health justice, by a lack of educational, I view every issue through a lens of health and equity, every single issue. And so the same is true when we're talking about these issues.
Yeah. It's remarkable to me because, we talk about this around what it was like for you to campaign against a Democratic incumbent, to campaign against someone who identifies as progressive, and where folks said, why are you going after this guy, right? Of all people. And I think we see it now in your conversation about the Internet, we see it now in your conversation about the Green New Deal. I'm wondering if you could just sort of take us a step back and go back to that time when you were campaigning and what it was like to combat those headwinds on the way to
It feels 1,000 years ago, and it feels like 5 minutes ago, truthfully. So first, let me just say this. I have tremendous respect for my predecessor. He was a mayor, he was a member of Congress, he served this district, and I am grateful for his contributions. I don't feel like I was running against anyone. I was running for the district. I never said or felt that I'm better. I was raised that way. I think I'm better than anyone. What I said is that I'm different, and that the district had changed, the needs of the district had changed. My predecessor had been elected 20 years ago with 23% of the vote, and had gone unchallenged for 20 years. And I felt that after a generation, the district deserved a choice, because the district had changed, the needs of the district have changed, and our country is in the midst of a major shift. And it's not one that I wanted to be along for the ride, it's one that I wanted to play a role in ushering in this paradigm shift, because this is the defining element of the country. It could be our darkest, or we can build the most inclusive progressive movement in history, because our organizing silos are being forced to break down, and people are being forced to understand that our destiny are tied. And so if you climate change, national security, immigration, these issues are all connected. And so what I saw was the party, and we can talk about that some more if you like. And sort of, and I me because you support reproductive justice. That's not the ceiling, that is the floor.
I can criticize this country. I can criticize
on mainstream traditional television because I didn't have the means. I wasn't accepting corporate PAC money. But even if I did have the money, I was not going to do those commercials. I made the decision instead, pardon me, that I'm going to invest in ethnic specialty media, radio, television, and print. And specifically, Latino and Spanish speaking media. So we did media buys and tell them we're going to do Vizio. And traditional consultants around the table said, this is the death knell. Do you hear it? This is the nail in your coffin. Your mission is 7% Latino, and this is where you're going to put your money. Guess what? We grew the Latino vote by 71%.
Natalie's on the app time for one more question. Okay. So I was flipping through and said,
you might have to look at